What's going on, everybody? It is Chris Akin back once again with another edition of Chris Akin Presents. I, of course, am Chris Akin. That guy over... Well, it's not Erik now, is it? That is because Erik is out and about traveling the country with the Stephen Pearcy band. He's out there rocking, and he's here on this coast, so he's cold as fuck being out here, but we're going to do something a little different today. Instead of doing a best of, we were going to record a show. It didn't happen. My fault. I'll take full blame on that. It was Erik had exactly one day to do it, and I chose that day to have a migraine, so it just didn't happen. That being said, I don't want to leave you guys without some new stuff. So we've definitely got a show for you here. As you can see on the screen, we're going to be talking to one of two bands here today. We're going to talk to two. So hang tight. You're going to hear some cool music and find out about one band that you don't know about, the other that you probably do. So starting off the show, we're going to talk with the fine folks of the band Paralandra. They are, if you're looking for a comparison, they definitely fall in that Taylor Momsen or Lizzie Hale Hailstorm sort of vibe. So if you like that kind of stuff, you'll like them. They're really, really good people though too. So great interview. We talked to them about their new single Dirty Love, their old album, COVID, chicks in bands, everything. So it's a pretty good conversation with the folks of Paralandra. And then following that, for you prog heads out there, we chatted at length with Mr. Mike Mangini, former drummer of Dream Theater, most recently let go member of Dream Theater, actually. We talked to Mike about leaving Dream Theater, talked to him about his new release, which is called Invisible Signs. And he does that with Chris Akin Presents veteran Jen Majura on vocals, who some of you might remember from Evanescence. A lot of different stuff. Talked about, he's offering these master classes if you're a drummer, any kind of musician, actually. And he swears that if you just follow the techniques that he offers in the master classes, you can play like a pro in 30 days. Well, maybe he doesn't say that, but he says that you will be improved in 30 days. So that's a lot of big words there, but he had a lot to say about it. And I'm going to tell you, he's awful believable. I don't know if he could turn a horrendous hack like me into something of a player, but maybe if you're even remotely involved in being a professional musician, you'll want to pay attention to this one as well. So good stuff coming up. It's going to be the interview edition of Chris Akin Presents. Of course, Erik will be back next week, as far as I know. And for the short term, before we go any further, let me just remind you, officialstephenpearcy.com. That is where you can keep up with Erik. That's where you can see where the shows are going to be at. You can also follow him on Instagram or Facebook, which I believe is just Erik Ferentinos. Of course, follow the show on Rumble, rumble.com/c/CMS. That's where the Rumble videos are. ChrisAkin.net is the web home where everything else is. All right. I don't need to be plugging. You know where to go. So let's get to it. Let's take a second, play a little bit of music from the band Paralandra, and we will be back with Paralandra and then Mike Mangini. So settle in for some good musical info next, right here on Chris Akin Presents.
Yeah.
is Chris Akin Presents, and I, of course, am Chris Akin. And today on the show, I am going to be presenting a band that, I'll be honest, I'm 11 years behind the eight ball on. I'm just discovering the band myself, but they kick ass, period. They are a great band. If you like kind of, I hate doing the comparison thing, but if you're sort of in that Hailstorm plush sort of thing, but heavier, I think, this would be a band for you. The band is called Paralandra, and joining me on the show is everybody. It is Paralandra. Hi, guys. How are you?
We're great. Hey. The whole gang's here.
That's right. We got everybody. So let's dig right into this. I admitted it. I was surprised that I usually know everything about everybody because I'm a total music dork. And I had not heard of you guys until Corey over there at Metal Shop told me about you. And then I went back and I started listening. I was like, damn, how did I miss this band? You know, you guys really have a great sound. And if I missed it, I'm going to assume that everybody else that I know missed it. So why don't we start there? Maybe somebody grab the ball and give us a little bit of history, you know, of the band and how we got to where we are today.
Well, I guess it all started with me and my dad here. And back in 2013 was, I guess, the inception of the band. So we've been together, I mean, going on 11 years as of next summer. Yeah. But when I was in like middle school, high school, you know, I started writing songs. And my dad has always been in bands for my whole life. So, of course, you know, I always go to him with my ideas. And anyway, then we kind of, over the years, started writing songs together, and we were like, well, why don't we perform some of these songs, you know, just for the heck of it? And so we, you know, put together a band just for like one show, and it went over really well, and people really loved the songs. So we were like, well, maybe we should do this again. And honestly, just we haven't stopped ever since then. So it's just kind of been this coincidental, really fun thing that we do for a living now.
Sure. No, no. Now I'll tell you guys, outside of playing radio guy, I have a few businesses and I have my sons that work with me, and that's not always fun. How do you determine when to be band guy versus when to be dad, you know, and play that game? Cause it's, you can admit it. The other three don't get it, but I get it.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a certain way you got to do it, and you can't be as harsh sometimes with your kid as much as you want to be. Yes?
Right, right. Yeah, you kind of have to feel it out. It was never something I, like, had a game plan for, but I will say this. Like, ever since she has been in this world, like, little bitty, we have had a blast together. I mean, from the time before she could walk, I remember I couldn't wait to get home to play with this little girl. And so we've always just had a really good connection and loved hanging out. And so it's actually very natural. And then as far as like, now that it's become like a, like what we do, you know, I kind of treat it like, I highly respect her because she's really talented. She's also very smart, very alpha and aggressive with, you know, getting things done. And so I trust her with this stuff. And I just relinquish a lot of things to her because she gets things done and very motivated. And so it's not that hard. And yeah, I don't know. It's not that difficult of a thing like you might think.
Sure. Well, then maybe you should run my businesses because it's a whole different animal over here. Well, let's talk about the music, guys. I know a zillion bands and they write one of two ways. They write music and then fill it with lyrics, or there's a lyric that inspires a song and then the music comes together behind the lyric or the idea of a lyric. How do you guys write, or do you use both depending on, you know, song to song?
Well, these two are the primary songwriters, but I would say, not being a primary songwriter and just guessing, that no, these guys usually come with either a riff or a melody to practice, usually maybe a verse chorus, and we just kind of progress from there. As far as their lyrical writing, I don't I don't really know how much they've progressed once they brought it to us, but like we have a song coming up on this new album that Cassandra was actually out of town for. So it was just us three guys practicing, and it was just, we pretty much wrote the instrumentation of the song in like one practice. And I don't think you had, or did you have lyrics at that point? I don't know if you did or not.
I had a few notes, but that was it.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's really kind of a toss up, 50-50, I would say.
Yeah, like for me, I mean, when I'm writing a song, a lot of the times it comes from just like singing little ditties in my head. Like I'll come across a word that is inspiring, like you said, and then start singing that word or singing that phrase. And then that just kind of branches out into everything else that comes with it. And then, you know, you just kind of try to build from there. But a lot of the time, you know, you have like killer riffs or like the further record riff. That was just a little thing that I was playing at practice one time and it turned into the whole song for the record. So I feel like it just is all the different ways.
Sure. Well, and that's probably the best way to keep the creative fresh, because then you don't have to wait on either side. It can come from either side. And, yeah. You know, I know a little about writing songs. I know enough to know that half the time you come up with something and you realize two thirds of the way into the song, it's not good. So, you know, that's it's probably better that you have both sides so that you're always fusing ideas together. No?
Yeah, definitely. Everybody works in tandem, all four of us, to improve whatever we're working on. So I don't think any song has been written independent of any one of us.
Okay. Yeah. Like yeah. Every single one of them has been collaborative. I mean, yeah. Like, I feel like our songs would definitely suck if it was just the way I wrote them.
Like, that's true.
They need collaboration. It's true.
Right on.
It's so lame compared to what they are now. And that's what's so cool about our music, I think, is you've got so many awesome ideas going on at the same time that really mesh together well.
Sure. Are the songs still changing? Because I know musicians, you guys are never satisfied. Are the songs from Street Magic that I can listen to, are they different now the way that you play them live?
We're always doing that. Like we were actually just, the last show we did, Cassandra's like, why don't we do this to the ending of this song? It's from our new album.
Yeah.
And so we literally have played this song like once live before, and all of a sudden we're changing it all.
It's not even out yet. And I'm like, I think we should actually extend this four measures. And
yeah,
it never stops. You're right.
Right. Very cool. Well, let's go backwards a little bit here. Let's go to 2021. You put out Street Magic. Great record. I mean, really catchy and hooky without being soft. That's the way I would present it to people.
Thanks.
That being said, you guys couldn't have picked a worse time to put it out if you tried. You know, right dead smack in the middle of the pandemic. Why did you decide to put it out? And were there at least conversations about let's hold it in? You know, at that time we didn't know how long it was going to last. Did you contemplate holding it to see, well, maybe we'll wait till we can go out and play it?
I mean, honestly, it lined up for us. I know there was a lot of craziness going on in the world in the music industry at that time, but where we were as far as writing, as far as playing shows, everything kind of lined up for us. So we decided to take a chance and just go for it. We wanted to work with Elvis Basquiat forever and ever, and we had our chance. So we wanted to go ahead and jump on that opportunity when we could, even though, I mean, it may not have been the absolute perfect time, but it was perfect for us. So we went ahead and just tried it out and see what would happen.
Sure. And working with Elvis, I mean, he is like the hot guy now. I mean, whether it's Seven Dust or Alter Bridge or, I mean, Elvis is a king.
Yep.
For you guys, though, and I'm always curious about this with any band, whether it's Megadeth or Metallica or band that's just starting out. When you work with somebody that has the platinum records on the wall, I have to imagine it is incredibly hard to say to him, nope, don't like what you're pitching me. I'm going to do it my way instead. How difficult is it to do that with a guy like Elvis?
It's not difficult at all, because we never say we don't like his ideas, because he doesn't have bad ideas. The guy is a genius.
But you know what's crazy is, like, this is the first album where the producer, Elvis, has been more into our ideas than his own. Like every other album we've done, the producers are like, well, you should cut this, you should do this, and you know, nobody's into guitar solos anymore, you need to cut that. And but Elvis was just like, dude, I want you to be yourselves. I want you to sound like yourselves. I don't want you to sound like me. And if I find something that I can improve on, I'll let you know. But he was like very much letting the reins go.
Yeah. It was really nice to like work with somebody that saw our vision and was able to just enhance it and, you know, kind of make it even tighter. So when we were in those, you know, first few days or like week of pre-production for Street Magic and for the new album coming out, like we're going through these songs and just making all these fine tunes, all of these little tweaks that just really, you know, set it all off and bring it all to life. So, I mean, dude, Elvis is the man. And any suggestions he has, I am all ears.
I'll give you an example. Like on For the Record, the bridge or the pre-chorus used to be the intro. And Elvis was like, you know what? I really love that riff. What if we just started that song with and we're like, never thought about that. And let's give it a shot. And it was better, you know?
Sure. Okay. Well, you know, it's crazy. A friend of mine is Mariah from Plush. And she worked with Johnny Kay, who's another unbelievable talent in his own right. And she was telling me, and she sent me some of it, that her songs were complete. They were done. They were demoed. They were everything. She went to Johnny Kay and he's like, nope, we're going to move this here. We're going to do the same things that you guys are saying. And it came out better. She said the hardest thing that she had to encounter was, since she crafted them one way, it took her probably 6 months of living with them to perform them the right way that they finished.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you guys have the same thing?
Oh yeah.
Definitely. Actually, I did that exact thing on For the Record when we played it on New Year's Eve. I started to play it our old ways with the pre-chorus as the intro, and I just had a brain fart and I was like, what is going on? What song is this? And then I was like, oh yeah. Anyway, sometimes you have those little moments.
Sure. No doubt. Let's talk about the current single. You guys just released the single for Dirty Love. Which is another cool song, another great tune. Tell us a little bit about the single and about the video.
Man, well, Dirty Love, I wrote it about just a new relationship that I had. It's about kind of just getting out of a relationship that was a piece of crap and then getting into a new one and being exposed to this brand new world that you never thought existed. So that's kind of like the whole concept of the song, but with the music video, you know, it's called Dirty Love, and you know, there's a lot of different ways that you could take that. You could go the way everybody's thinking, or you could go the Paralandra route and take it literally into actual dirt. And so we made a mud pit tug of war, and we have us versus different versions of ourselves, or different career paths we could have taken. And just like fighting it out. And there's all different versions. It's hilarious. If you haven't seen it, go watch it. But yeah, so it's just kind of about like, who are you gonna be? Who's gonna win? You know, which version of yourself is gonna be the one that ends up on top? So.
Right on. Well, why don't we do this? Let's take a little bit of a break. We'll give people a taste of Dirty Love right now. We'll play a little bit of the video. So stay tuned. Check out the tune. It is Dirty Love and it is Paralandra right here on Chris Akin Presents.
Just to touch, baby, that's my kind of time.
Right back here on Chris Akin Presents, we are talking with the fine folks of Paralandra. Their album for 2021 is Street Magic, which is out there on all your streaming services. I'm going to say don't stream it. For God's sakes, do not stream it. Buy it. And I'm going to start right there. Yes. Where? Please tell everybody where to buy it. I'm kidding a little about the streaming. Go listen to it to understand it. But buy it. Buy merch. Help these guys. Where do we tell them to go?
ParalandraRocks.com.
That's right. Get merch. Everything.
There we go. And what kind of merch can they find over there?
Dude, shirts, cups, caps, hoodies, bracelets, wristbands.
Posters.
Shoehorns. With our logo on it, we'll do it.
Nice. Very cool. I do tell everybody that, and you know, for one main reason, because the streaming thing, they make it so impossible for you guys to make a living doing it. It's just it's stupid. I mean,
make a living doing it streaming. We sure can't do it. You know what I'm saying? But I mean, it's good to get the music out there, but truly bands are falling, you know, like flies right now, because the only way we can make money is like you said, merch or ticket sales, you know, people shows. So appreciate that.
Absolutely. Well, and you know, the thing is not only is streaming difficult, you know, to make your money, but then you don't get all your money. And I only know this because I do a business on the side with that's what we do, is help artists find their royalties. And there's so, you know, there's so much that you guys don't get that you should be getting, which is a whole can of worms. I could tell you at a different time if you're interested in that. But it's just amazing to me that this industry doesn't understand that it's killing itself by not teaching bands or showing you or just doing for you like they did in the old days. In the old days, you know, of course every band will tell you they got ripped off, but let's face it, they got ripped off after cashing a $2.5 million check, you know.
Yeah,
you know,
kind of ripped off.
Yeah, now it's, you know, you guys can generate a million streams and get a check for that won't pay for dinner, and it's crazy. It's just nuts. But you know, that is what that is. But well, let's go on to actual playing shows, because you guys have played some very high profile stuff. You guys have played in front of a lot of great bands. You've played at festivals. I personally am a little bit torn for bands like yourselves as far as getting out in front of big bands, because with the attention span the way people are today, you get a lot of people that sit in the parking lot drinking beer instead of coming in and learning new bands. For you guys, what are you seeing? Are the shows in front of big bands helpful? Do you get a lot of guys with their arms crossed and are just like, when does Alice in Chains come on? God damn it. You know, what are you guys seeing when you get out there?
Well, dude, honestly, we love being the underdogs, and I mean, not to be, you know, braggy or anything, but we win over every single crowd that we play for. And I mean, like when we played with Warrant in Sparks, Nevada a couple months ago, it was for this huge brat fest or something.
Rib fest.
That's right. Okay. Anyways, crazy huge event, like thousands and thousands of people walking through there. Whenever we went on, I mean, there was a couple hundred people like kind of scattered around, but by at least halfway through our set, it was packed, like at least 1,000 people. And I mean, literally, people just come in and they eat it up. They love it. So I love being the underdog. I love going on first, because no one is expecting what we're about to put on. So
plus, we're just performers. I mean, you've never seen us live, but yeah. So it's one of those things, you just got to be there and experience to really understand. But
sure. Is it difficult to, is there one crowd, I guess, that's more difficult than the other? I mean, Warrant just doesn't seem like the crowd I would expect to see you guys at. I would expect to see you more in front of, I don't know, The Warning or Hailstorm or, you know, those sort of bands.
I don't know. We played in front of a lot of different sounds. We played in front of the heaviest of the heavy metal bands. We played in front of indie bands. We've had openers that are, you know, country rock, rockabilly type stuff. We have all kinds of different genres that either play before us, play after us, play with us, whatever it is. And it always seems like if you're just a music fan, you like music. So even though they may be a favorite of a different genre, if we play well, they're going to enjoy it. At least that's what we hope to achieve.
Yeah,
I feel like our genre of rock, too, is just like it's very versatile. And people that lean on the heavier side, like they'll still like our heavy riffs and maybe we'll be a little bit lighter than they're used to. Or people that typically don't like music as heavy as ours, they really like our melodies and the message and stuff. So I feel like it's a really nice middle ground where, I mean, we can play with, like you said, like black metal or like pop or, you know, like Southern rock or something. So
right on. Now Cassandra, I'm gonna throw this one straight to you. I chatted yesterday with Doro Pesch, and you know, she's obviously maybe the, for women, she is probably the one in hard rock heavy metal that kicked the door open 40 years ago or whatever.
Right.
That being said, I couldn't give her that compliment. She wouldn't take it. She was just like, oh, it's everybody, it's the work, it's this and that. For you, seeing how the world is today, you know, women are fronting tons of bands now to where that's not a thing anymore. It's really not a thing anymore. It's not surprising when you see that. But when you look at it, you know, now, do you still feel like you have to perform better, work harder, be better, just because, you know, somewhere maybe deeper in deep psychology, people are still hanging on to that?
I mean, at the beginning of this band, it was definitely something that annoyed me because, like, sound guys would just assume that my guitar was a prop and that I didn't actually play it. Like, they'd be like, oh, you want me to mic your amp? Why? Like, because I play the guitar. But anyways, I think that over the years, you know, we've kind of made a name for ourselves. But even people that haven't heard of us, like, they just have a little bit more respect for women nowadays. And so it's not really a question anymore. And honestly, I just feel like another person in the industry. It's not really like a male or female thing. You know, it's just we're a bunch of people out here trying to do our best. And, you know, me personally, I am a very driven person. So just already I have a fire inside of me that's wanting to do better and go harder and make things bigger. So that's not really driven by, well, I'm a female, so I got to work harder.
Right.
It's just like me as a person. I need to work harder. I need to do better. So, I don't really pay attention to the whole male female thing in the music industry. It doesn't make a difference for me.
If you're good, you're good.
That's it.
Right. Agree. Let's talk a little bit about touring itself. Obviously it's a different animal than it was even 3 years ago, with a lot less places to play, $4 to $6 a gallon of gas. Yeah. You know, it's harder to get gigs, you know, a lot more Monday gigs being offered than Saturday gigs. You know, it just seems like it's harder. How is it for you guys to get out there? Is it extremely difficult, or do you have to kind of sit back and wait for a tour, a package that you can get on? Do you have to buy on? I mean, what is the environment these days?
It's kind of all the above, honestly. A lot of venues are struggling, and we try to keep that in mind. Like, this is a partnership when you're talking about a band and a venue, you know, and we realize that. And we have venues that, I mean, we'll have shows that get canceled because the venue's just like, yeah, we're just not making money. We had a New Year's Eve show booked earlier in 2023, and it got canceled because they shut down. Like, and it was a big, really nice venue. So, you know, we try to keep that in mind, and it is tougher. It is tougher to book. We usually book our own tours, though we're with an agency that will put us on the bigger things, like the more high profile festivals, and like this thing we're getting ready to do in Key West, the Rock Island. Mm-hmm. You know, they hook us up with a lot of that stuff. And so it's really great to have those guys helping us out. But yeah, it's tough, dude. It's tough. And like you said, with the gas, we're out there just driving it out.
Yeah. Dude, we were in California a couple months ago, and what was the highest we saw? Like
750 or 760, somewhere like that.
760 a gallon. I mean, literally just murder.
And we were sure to stop there and fill up.
Yeah.
On an empty tank.
There wasn't another gas station for 300 miles.
That's almost like putting out the sign that says "Don't come to California." I mean, good lord, that's so expensive.
It's true. It's not like they pay you better out there. You just suffer more with more sun.
What? You guys can answer this, or you can politely say pass, and I'm fine with that. But since we're talking about venues, what do you guys think about venues taking that percentage off of you guys for shirts and merch and stuff?
Oh, dude, it is literally robbery. It makes no sense. It is the dumbest thing that they could possibly do, and I hate it.
Give us a percentage of your bar, and we'll give you a percentage of our t-shirts.
You want a percentage of our shirts? Give me a percentage of every cocktail you make tonight.
Yeah.
We hate them.
it is robbery. It is unlawful, and we don't appreciate it.
Yeah, I agree with you fully. I couldn't believe when bands started telling me about this. You know, I get it. Like you guys said, the venues are struggling, but you know what? If they don't have anybody on the stage, they're not open. So why take, and you guys are playing for crumbs. I mean, not you necessarily, just bands in general. The biggest bands that come to their clubs, you know, if you go to a casino show and they're getting paid big band, if it's, I don't know, Rat or somebody, and they're getting paid $30,000, by the time you divide all that out and take out the flights and take out the hotels and take everything out, they're making not minimum wage, but they're making a whole lot less than a band with 40 years of success should be making.
A lot less than you would think. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a holdover from that era, though, from the era of the 80s and, mm-hmm. and before, the holdover when they were making tons of money on physical distribution, which that's not the case anymore. And so there are some of these venues that kind of take advantage of that old grandfathered way of doing things, you know? So, it's ridiculous. And we've been in that situation where we've been, touring with a larger act and we're just the opening act. And this particular venue, they take a percentage, even from the headlining artists, they take a percentage of merch, and it's just, they need to be called out on it.
Yeah.
Some venues, like you said, that some venues that are struggling take percentages. We played for plenty that are doing just fine to take percentage.
The bigger ones are the ones that want your merch cut.
It's true. It's never the dirt venues that want your merch cut. It's always the fancy places that are doing fine.
Yeah.
Remain nameless.
Yeah, and that's why they're doing fine, because they're robbing you guys to do it, I guess. Jeez. Yeah. That is, it's just such bad business. I mean, just in general, that's how do you charge your talent? That would be like charging your waiter, you know, 20% of his pay to serve in order to serve food. It doesn't make any sense, but somehow, but again, this industry, anything's possible, because Lord knows that's how it's always been.
Oh, yeah.
I still keep getting surprised, so.
I hear you. When we catch up with you guys 2 years from now, where will you be? What level will you be at? And what will it take for you to consider the album that we're going to hear soon to be successful? In your eyes, whatever successful is.
Wow, that's a tough question.
2 years.
Dakota. You've got the answer to that, right?
He's got the answer.
Well, I know that as long as we don't stay stagnant or we don't like rest on our laurels, I kind of get annoyed whenever bands find success and then just keep milking that success years and years down the road instead of trying new things or growing. So I think for me, I would just like to see us grow in every different direction. I think that's pretty much the biggest goal for us, is just to keep growing, never stay stagnant, never go backwards. So I know that's not very specific, but as long as we just keep improving and growing as a unit, I think that's most important for me.
Maybe another album. Who knows? I mean,
this guy's hair will get longer.
Yeah.
That's one of my goals.
Yeah.
If this album can take me from bologna sandwiches to ham sandwiches, I will be content.
From hot dogs to brats.
Yeah.
Very good. Well, very cool. Let's do the plugs real quick here. Where should we tell people one more time to go to keep up with you guys, tour dates, you know, the talk a little bit about Rock Island and, you know, any other big ones that you've got coming up that you want people to know about, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, you can find everything Paralandra related on our website, paralandrarocks.com. You can find our music, tour dates there, merch. You can pre-order the new album as well as a bunch of other really cool things on there. But definitely go check us out on all the streaming platforms as well, because we're on Spotify, iTunes, Apple Music, all those things. And then lastly, I would highly recommend checking out our YouTube channel. We have a lot of really great music videos. They are highly entertaining, and I highly recommend them.
That's true. We don't phone any of those videos in. I mean,
we take great pride in our music videos.
Yeah. They are the funnest part of this band.
Very cool. Well, guys, I figured we'd wrap this one up with the video for the record. Great video. We'll share that with everybody. What can you tell us about the song and the video to wrap it up?
For the record, I wrote years and years ago when we were first starting in this band. And, you know, we just kept getting told we needed to change. We needed to, you know, I needed to lose weight. They already had a Lizzie Hale, so find something else to do. You know, we just kept being told that just we weren't good enough and we weren't enough and enough, you know, just in all different areas of the band. So anyways, I just wrote this song out of my frustration at the music industry and just said, you know what? I'm perfect the way I am. And for the record, I'm not changing for anybody. And so far that has proven to be extremely successful for me and for this band. So I want to spread that message to everybody else out there to just be who you are. Don't let anybody else tell you otherwise.
Right on. Makes a lot of sense to me. So let's do it right now. Let's play it. It is For the Record. It is Paralandra. And guys, thanks so much for joining me here on CHRIS AKIN Presents.
The internet has changed the game to where you don't need millions of dollars to own your own viable radio or TV station. A good concept and a great streaming platform are all you need. We've got that platform for you. Unket Drunk Noise is the best place to stream your very own online radio or TV station. We offer 24/7 scheduling, on-demand options, the ability to go live on your channels, and much, much more. Sell and plug in your own advertisements within your programming as you see fit. Our stations are fully licensed and legal. It's all here for you, so get started today. Just visit www.uncontrolledNoise.com and let us know you are ready to broadcast. Uncontrolled Noise, your best place for online radio and television stations.
Right back here on Chris Akin Presents. And today on the show, we are going to talk to an absolute legend, and more than a legend, an absolute beast. And I do say that with all the love in the world. This guy is a monster behind the drum kit. And as a failed drummer, I am beyond envious of the skill level that this guy has. You certainly know him from the past decade or so with Dream Theater. Obviously, he was in Annihilator, Extreme, worked with Steve Vai, worked with everybody that is a virtuoso, because he is a virtuoso. He is Mr. Mike Mangini. Mike, how are you, sir?
Very well. That's quite an intro. I was wondering if you're talking about someone else.
Well, come on, man. All kidding aside, whether you believe it or not, you know what the world thinks of Mike Mangini, the drummer, as one of the top guys. No?
Gosh, it's interesting. I have to answer your question. That it appears a lot of people get what I do. Not everybody likes it. Most seem to, because sure, the venues were full. So I guess it means people like something. But thank you. I appreciate that. I worked so hard, though, and my sights are always basically moving forward, because I'm seeing what's got to be done. But anyway, thank you.
Absolutely. Well, let's talk about what is the present, man, which is start with the brand new release, Invisible Signs. Great record. You worked with one of my absolute favorite people on this entire planet, Jen Majura. She, I don't even care about her musical prowess or any of that. She's the most fun person I know, maybe on the planet. She is just a lot of fun and incredibly talented. But you worked with her not playing guitar as much as a singer. What was it that led you to her as a singer versus bringing her in to be a guitar player?
Well, there wasn't any choice, because the guitar was done.
Okay.
So that's that. But I did have her play lead with the intro on Deep Inside. And she had mentioned that she felt that it needed a little something there, and I didn't hold that view for the longest time, because I was used to the song and I wanted the air. But because she suggested it, it made me think, well, she could play. That would be cool. And it was more important to me to have her play than to hold on to, well, my demo-itis or the view. It's just like, just go play. So she did get to play that solo. And it's all on her. Like, go ahead, do you like this? Okay, it's printed. You know, I didn't tell her anything except have fun. But the vocal came about because of numerous changes and morphs while I was writing lots of songs over the years without releasing a solo album. And although I had, been close, and I've worked with the whole pile of singers in different ways and capacities and trying things, it came about because she asked me to be a part of her 1 minute jam to play a Stevie Wonder song. And when I heard her sing it, I heard the swagger.
Okay.
I heard it, because a lot of things that I do, I've been in situations that, post my recording, the swagger kind of gets removed. With the whole era of sound replacement or whatever, just editing the sessions, or I would just record pieces and then they get put together. I mean, in the session drummer guy mode, that's how it works. But mm-hmm. I just stepped away and walked away. I didn't even think about it twice about what happened to my playing in my drums. It's like, that was the job. That was it. So she had that swagger. And I thought that some of the songs on the record, because all of them were written for a lay audience, they were not written for the Prague audience. Obviously, now I played like crazy in the middle, but you got to understand what my target audience was and why mm-hmm. it was. But with that said, my kids were listening to like everything, and they did clue me in on popular almost, I don't even know what it's called. I honestly don't know what it's called. It's like sort of rap music, but it's not. But anyway, I listened to the grooves, which I was very familiar with, and I was like, okay, let me try to reach them with something like in Black Box or Let Me Shine. Right. And it's and other tunes too. The swing, the swag is there, because I know, I can tell you, because everyone that recorded the tracks, they went to me to do what I did before I sent them off to Jimmy T.
Okay.
To do the mix. But anyway, so I can see what's happened. I can see my drum parts. There's swagger, there's the swing thing. And she was able to, when I heard her, I was like, she's going to lock into this. And she did.
Right on. And, yeah. And for you, Mike, you know, no secret, you're coming out of Dream Theater, and that's a band that everybody's a virtuoso in. Every single person, and I assume, and this is an assumption, tell me if I'm wrong, but I'm assuming that each one of you has to kind of fight to get your vibe and your feel into it and make it fit the songs. That being said, with this is all about you, where you can really stretch out. Is this more comfortable for you, that you can write music instead of writing to more or less a part that fits a longer epic sound?
Oh, it's tough. I just adjust for the situation. Okay. You know, I try not to have a wall of opinion or feelings or anything like that in front of the job that has to be done. I'm looking at the job and go, and I think, what can I do to make to do the best job in the parameters that exist here? Because I don't try to change parameters. It's like going outside and getting mad at the weather.
Right.
Just, it's raining. How about a raincoat? You know, so I just adjust for the situation. And in my solo album situation, believe it or not, although the process was only in all me, living alone is no fun. It really is not. And so I needed to feel comfortable to express myself to myself, and also to examine my growth. Like, let me just try to write. You know, I've never been a lyric guy. And all of a sudden, now today, I'm spewing them out like crazy. At any rate, but I see I tapped into a system. So I always find a system for something. It's like in the master classes. Okay, yeah, I'm not going to sit there and go through all of these books that I published.
Sure.
And yeah, they're based in cognitive science and physics and there's some math stuff and computer stuff, which is you could probably tell, but I tried to not make it be that way, but it's a system. So if I can't play something on the drums, I have a system to fix it. When sure. I do my cameos, and when I was a counselor, I had to have a system to help someone not hurt themselves. I mean, like badly, because people are in trouble in life.
Right.
So for the solo record, I had a system. For the lyrics, I now have a system. And the bottom line is that I needed to put that down and then have the wherewithal to step back to say, gee, does that riff even work on that instrument, where instead of this and this, you have right. this and this?
Right.
This is not the same as this. So when people that do this keyboard write for people that do this, the people that do this do not get very happy.
Right.
Okay? But because it's not in the language, and they got to do things that are like, I want to do that. So I recognized all this. I was like, okay, I'm writing all this on virtual instruments, because I tried my little trick at guitar and bass and just put it down. Like, it's people alive that spent the time you did playing the drums doing this. Let them do what they do, and bring to the table things you, meaning me, would never see. It's not in my worldview of that. I don't have the ground experience. Like, step away. So yeah, it was all me for a while. I wrote everything, every single note, and then I turned it over to people quite a bit better than me at doing what they do, and I gave autonomy. But okay. they still had to stick to the song. Because there's a lot of unisons. You can't really change much right. in a unison, and the chord is the chord. If you want to hit an O minus or an M plus or a K, you know, okay, but it's in the key of, you know, whatever.
Right.
X Prime or what, I just don't want to name notes because whatever. there's only certain, there's so much you could do. So
right on.
That was the process. It was me to a point, and then I was like, back off. Even the mix. You see, we've done a few slightly different things, but Jimmy T, in order to be the best he is, in order for me to benefit from his being the best he is, I had to step back on some things, and he had to step back on some things. Like,
right.
I find the power in the drums to be in the cymbals, because when you play the drum set, they're louder than the kick drum. So why is the mix all bombastic kick drum that doesn't even sound like a kick drum half the time? And,
right.
and the snare drum is, I don't know what that's turned into in this day and age. But I try to like take a little piece of, oh, I kind of get that. The sound cuts through, blah, blah, blah. It's a good sound. Like, okay, I'm going to have no feelings about it and just look at it and say, what does it do? And can I benefit from it? And so that's how I approached it. And, you know, Jimmy T was given autonomy. I'm like, just send me your heart. Let's go from there.
Right on. As a guy that has jumped into several big bands, you know, and as we mentioned before, Dream Theater, Extreme, Annihilator.
Yeah.
How does this feel different for you? And by different, I mean, is it intimidating that it is now Mike Mangini? It's not, well, the other guys that have been there can kind of take the blame if people don't like it, where it's all you now. You know what I mean?
It's not. Nothing intimidates me. I don't know why. Okay. My oldest best friend in the world. Well, but there's things we should be afraid of. I don't want to get deeply philosophical here. Sure, of course. Sure. Yeah, I didn't fall off an onion truck. But with where we're going with this, no. And it's because, you know, I'm a musician, but I did my work playing the drums. So the lyrics that aren't so this good grade or the solos that I wrote, I don't even do that. So I don't have the ego with it. I don't have the ego with the lyric. I mean, even working with Jen, where she knows me, all right. And she was able to say anything. And I liked it. I appreciated it because when she had something to say, it's like, this word isn't doing what it's got to do. It's like, oh, okay, give me a minute. Or this thing, you know, makes sense on the paper maybe. And I know this. It just, because things have a sound first. And I told her that. If it's a meaningful lyric, well, that's a processing thing, but the sound comes first. If someone doesn't like the sound, they don't get to the meaning, or it doesn't sound any good. Plus, you got lyrics like do-do-do-do, da-da-da-da. They don't mean anything.
Right.
Or maybe don't. Maybe they mean something to Sting or mean something to somebody. That's fine, but they don't mean anything on the surface, and they just sound good. So you got to find that balance. Anyway, with whatever suggestions she had when she reached a point where she wanted to not sing what was there, I was like, okay, because I'm not attached to it, and like, it's mine or it means this, and you've got it. It's like, so what? I mean, it's like, I'll find something that sounds better, and then I have a system to find something that meaning wise works with the thing.
Right on. Well, I'll tell you what, Mike, let's take a little break here and give people a taste of some of the music that you've got on the new album, Invisible Signs. We're going to play the video for Not Drowning. What can you tell us about this song?
That it musically, it encompasses my vibe for riffs and my love of heaviness. It also encompasses what I do more than what people know, which is power the music and leave some space for the riffs and things like that. And, you know, I just want to, the heavier it is, the less I play in a way. But bottom line is I did fuse in kind of some rhythmic stuff, over the bar stuff, which happens later in the song. So it's there for the people that want a little more, like, well, what is that pattern? I'm like, okay, there's some of that stuff, but it's basically just a heavy tune, and it has a lot of dynamic ups and downs in it. And the lyric itself, like all of them, are completely able to be interpreted by people. So I kind of laced them with multiple things for that purpose. And whatever you get from it, you get from it. And that's what it is. As long as you like the vibe and you think that it flows, and by the time it's over, you go, oh, I want to hear that again. That's all I care about.
All right. Well, let's see if people do want to hear it over again and again. It is not drowning. It is Mike Mangini from the Invisible Signs release. And we'll be back to talk with Mike more about the master classes that he's doing right now. And as a failed drummer, I definitely have a question or two. Well, let's check out Not Drowning right now. It is CHRIS AKIN Presents. Right back here on CHRIS AKIN Presents, we are talking with the great Mike Mangini, brand new release, Invisible Signs. It is available now. I strongly suggest you buy it. Don't just stream it. It's fine to stream it if you want to figure out what it's about, but buy it, please, people. Where can we send people before we start talking masterclasses, Mike?
To my link tree. It's on every one of my social media accounts, and every one of my websites links to it, as I built a structured network. So. Okay. Link tree. You can find anything you want.
Is it just link tree Mike Mangini?
Oh no, just I own link tree. Just go to link tree.
Oh, okay, there you go.
No. No, on the link tree website, it's Mike Mangini official.
Okay, excellent.
But again, it's in like link to my bio, that insta face thing, you know,
right?
Link to the bio. It's in the bio. So
very nice.
Whatever.
Well, Mike, let's talk masterclasses, man. But before I ask a question or two, just give people an overview of the masterclasses and what you expect them to get from experiencing your classes for them.
I expect them to get way more than they're paying for. What I mean by that is to save 10 years off their lives, to achieve things they didn't think were achievable, to feel differently, to view differently based on the system I'm bringing in, and the ease with which I can communicate it and have them go from point A to point Q right in the class. So that's what they get. They're going to save a lot of time in where they're trying to go.
Right on. Now, as I mentioned before, I am a failed drummer. I did try it 800 years ago. I'm not going back to it, but I know why I wasn't good at it. I know.
Why?
Because two reasons. One, very big lack of patience. You know, that was the first thing. I did not have the patience to do it. And second was I made what I think, and you could tell me if I'm wrong, I made the 100% of drummers that fail mistake, which is I wanted to play songs before I had basic technique down. I figured out how to do a couple of things, and then I'm like trying to play For Whom the Bell Tolls or whatever. You know, I just didn't learn the basics, and I didn't have lack of commitment and, you know, whatever. I was 18 years old when I tried. For a guy like me, or for guys that are decent but unsatisfied with their playing, what is one thing that you would tell them or teach them that could raise their playing to a more professional level?
The first thing I would say is that they have to be open to hear about the possibility of a different way to view it. Okay? Because because you had your worldview of it, your perception of it was only based on the things that you put in there or that were presented to you. That's what you saw.
Sure.
So that's not your fault or anybody's fault. It is the situation. But your will could have changed if, let's say, you were living on a piece of paper and you know, and it's a two-dimensional space, and you only saw the world that way, and that's how you saw drums. So for whom the bell tolls, I can't do that. But that one day somebody said, well, in order for you to understand this thing, this space you live in, we're going to take you up a dimension to three dimensions, and now you're up above, and you, now you can see things you didn't see before, or that circle that was on the ground that went like this and that went like that was nothing more than a ball going through your surface, but you couldn't perceive the three dimensions. You only saw what you saw. So what if your view changed? You see, so yeah. For someone that wants to be a professional, they've got to step away and learn to ask questions like, okay, who and what am I? What do I do? What do I want to do? Oh, I want to be a professional. What is that? What does that mean? You step away from it, you see, oh, it's an environment. Well, what's in the environment? Components, like what? Certain kinds of jobs, certain locations, and people. So right. If you learn that the connection between you and this professional environment is related to human interaction, you see it differently. You go, wait a minute, I've got to connect to this. Like, all right, this is this song I want to play from whom the bell tolls. But I've got to connect to it. I've got to connect to it somehow. Well, that's a different thing than, well, I want to play that song in a professional environment. That's a different right. thing because now it involves linking to people. And you have to like know who and what you are and be together to put yourself in that environment, because now you too are a component of it. So you've got to know how it works. You have to see it for what it is. You have to understand how people work. You have to know how to communicate in that environment, you know? Right. And so that's it. You've got to view it maybe from a different perspective and consider all of the angles that you might not have considered before.
Sure. How did you, and this is just curiosity, how did you have that kind of vision as a young kid? Because you've been a master player since you were young. You know, when I was 20 years old, there was no way I had that much, you know, forethought about myself or a job or doing anything to where I would analyze it. How did you have that from such a young age?
Well, I didn't have it at a global. Okay. I absolutely didn't, because I wasn't. Let me give you an example, because when it came time for college, I had scholarship letters from everybody and offers, and because I had competed and I won as high as you can go as a classical drummer. Competed. Won. I literally competed and won as high as you could go in the jazz genre, and I did drum contests and I won them, and I did drum auditions and I won those. It's like my father said, you're not going to go to school for something that you can do that well. Why don't you go learn something else? So, and I listened to him, and because I listened to him, I went to, I don't want to go off on too many tangents. I was going to major in mathematics and minor in music, and I just couldn't bear the thought of the musical situation it was. It's like, no, I'm not going to be put in that thing. I right. won't get into why. So I was like, I did business and software engineering, and software engineering led to, I'm going to go back to your question. Just give me a second.
Sure.
You know, that led to my software engineering accounting for my having a vision of anything you could do with eight notes in an array or in binary with zeros and ones, because not everyone can read. You can't see this. Not everyone can read sheet music. So I decided, right. I'm going to relate to people, and I'm going to have a zeros and ones, zero binary representation of the sheet music. So the point is, you don't have to look at this. It's if I didn't listen to him, none of this would have happened, and I never would have developed who I am. But stepping back to where did I have the wherewithal? I didn't. What I mean by that is I found out that no matter how skilled I got in my basement, I neglected to see that going to a music school connects you to people.
Right.
You know, because even when I taught at Berkeley, these students are getting big gigs. I'm like, I didn't even have access to those big gigs. How did they do it?
Right.
They connected to people. That supports my claim. Supports my claim of, you ask me one thing, if you want to be a professional, well, define what it is. Look at it in as many ways as you can. So I did not have the wherewithal. I will tell you what happened. I have been given gifts of vision, gifts of problem solving that come to me. They come to me in the form of seeing. I can see structure. I don't know. It comes to me. But at some point now, I had to go to work to manifest this myself, to create it myself, to problem solve myself, even though things still come to me. So it's a gift, all right? But on the other side of it, I had to do like everyone else and work very hard without much patience, right?
Right.
To, and I'm going to get to something important for you, to, okay, you know, to learn. So I read a lot of philosophy books. All of a sudden, these things that were so easy for me with math stuff that doesn't hit everybody started to hit me philosophically. It hit me organically. It hit me in ways it didn't say in the book. I was like, whoa, that's what I do. That's how I view things. And so I had to learn. I had to learn structure. I learned that the people I looked up to and trusted more than those I did not had structured minds. They were able to see like a roadmap and say, don't go down that street. Because right. look where it leads. So I developed it, but I have been given gifts. And I still have the gift. I've developed who I am, not because it happened, because it just happened. It happened because I had a visual of something, of a structure of information somehow forms these hierarchical structures. I don't know how to explain it. Look, it's
right.
Maybe not, the world doesn't see it all the same, but I see information and I see how to get from one thing to another. And I see things that are maybe true and untrue and false and how they work. And it's crazy how it comes to me, but I did not have it. All I did was I felt something like a magnet pulling me, a magnet to this drummer. It's like, I don't right. know why, but I need to learn what they do. I just like it.
Right.
I don't know why, but I'm not going to learn those albums. I don't like that music. It bores me. I like this and I like that. Unless someone changes my mind, which comes back to you and patience. Do you know that sometimes us coming upon a view of something changes our will? We didn't have the will before. We didn't want to sacrifice, or we didn't want to accept somebody, or we didn't want to accept something we didn't want to be true, that might be true, or that we didn't think was true, or all these things. If we see things in as many ways as we can, it changes our will. And that's the premise of my first book. And I'm just not like pumping the book. I'm just letting you know.
No, it's all good.
You know, it's like I have stick figure pictures. And my co-writer, who sadly passed away, would say things to me like, Mike, seriously, you want me to put a stick figure in the book? It's like, come on, man. Like, let's get a good picture. And I was like, no. I made a claim. I gave an answer, but I backed it up by saying, I want the optics to be as simple as possible. And I don't want it to look like anyone in particular. I just want it to be the skeleton that's inside. We all have a skeleton.
Sure.
Well, just we're all the same.
Right.
Like, so I don't even need to show it to you, but
no.
All right. So I'm getting a little deeper.
No, it's all good.
It's part of when I'm in the masterclass, you know, let's get back to you for a minute, is that if your vision changed a little bit, you would develop more patience. If I could tell you that you could learn that song in less than 2 months, no matter what it entails, you might not believe it at first, but if I was to make that claim and back that claim and show you, explain sure. how you would do that, you might have belief. And then if you had belief, you would get through obstacles.
Right. I needed you in the 90s, Mike.
Yeah, I know. Well, hey, I didn't know. I learned. I learned from my students. My students right. say make a statement. They would give me their view on something that I didn't see because I'm not them, and I would listen to them and say, gosh, I didn't see it that way. Thanks. And it helped me fill the pieces to a bigger puzzle.
Right. So, certainly.
So if you yeah, so go ahead.
Well, how do we tell people to come to sign up to attend these master classes?
Well, the first thing is by going to my website, just my name, MikeMangini.com. You can go to the master class link, or you go to the link tree, and I made it yes. specific one. So right. first of all, see where they are. And you go to that store website or you call them, then that's it. Because they take care of the registration.
Okay.
Because they are the ones deciding what room it's going to be in and putting a pad, you know, a snare pad and a space for people to sit. They don't need gear. You know, you could go with nothing.
Okay.
because the fundamentals that I teach have to strip down and help people get rid of bad habits anyway. So I have to get back to the fundamentals. I have to do it. I had this discussion with someone I'm just shocked became a friend of mine, baseball coach Tony La Russa.
Oh, yeah.
He's a Hall of Fame guy, you know, and developed a friendship. And we gravitated towards liking the fact that we both understood the role of fundamentals. And he shared some stories with me about like players that the difference, some players don't want to work on their fundamentals. They think it's bored by it. And other players want to work on the fundamentals. But with my view of it, it's like, well, the player that doesn't want to do it just is not seeing the big picture. And right. they might not be thinking about what they actually are. They're a human person. You forget things. You start to forget, like, you know, which is why the Dream Theater show, as complex as it was for me to hold it together I had to sync. Everything was synced. Everything was clicked out and synced to the production and all that. For me to do that with that music is, it's way harder than not having it. There's a view that the music's harder to play with no click and no this. That is absolutely untrue, given the view that I have. That's untrue, given the way that my experience, and if I make that claim, I'm going to back that claim up, and I might be wrong.
Right.
All right. Someone might present me something. It's like, well, I disagree with you, but why? Why? On what grounds? Show me. So I can learn, because I'm going to do interviews and I'm going to have this opinion. I don't want to look like a buffoon when I'm wrong. But I only know what I know right now. I only know what I know. But for me to hold it together, my protocol was turn left. That's how basic my fundamentals were during a Dream Theater show. Turn left, turn right. He's walking down the stairs, foot on the ground. Go ahead.
Okay.
13, it's 13, it's 15. There are three of these. I'm in the third verse. It's the third verse. I have to like stay in the moment. Otherwise, I'm looking around, looking at the sports banners in an arena and thinking, Detroit Pistons. This happened to me. Detroit Pistons. That's the year they beat my Celtics. Oh, that Rodman or the Bill Laimbeer. I hated Bill Laimbeer. I respect everyone just being a fighter, but you know. But my point is, my thoughts would get taken away, so I had to stay in the moment and to do with the 3 hours. And it's like most of the time, not miss a note. Of course, that would be. Like scorecards would be held up that I won't use the word as I'm not very good. I'm this, I'm that, I'm, you know.
Right.
And then it went from I didn't play it right to that I look like a grandmother and my goggles and my hair and my. This is hilarious.
My sister,
I think I was another gift I got was humor. I think stuff that's not supposed to be funny is very funny.
Right.
Anyway, no. We'll back up. So you will. Your hope can increase based on the view that you have. So in the masterclass, I assess everyone. I can see mechanically where the block is. If they want to get if from here to there, I see the map. And I go, well, we're going to take this street. You could take that street. But if you're going to take that street, you're going to have to take a left over here to get to the same destination. You're going to. So.
Right. No question.
But it's fundamentals.
Right. And that's what people should be coming. People shouldn't be coming out to get their copy of The Astonishing signed. They should be coming out to learn to be better drummers, correct?
Or better musicians, because everyone's invited.
Okay.
We're all human. True. The bass player with the index in the middle, the guitar player with the downstroke and upstroke, that's the same thing functionally as my right and my left, my dominant, my weak. It works the same way. Anyway.
Right on. Well, Mike, I'm going to ask one or two about the DT thing, just one or two, and they're not big, deep ones, but I am curious, given that Invisible Signs was ready pretty much the same time the announcement was made, did you have advance notice that this was coming and, you know, that you were leaving and Portnoy was coming in, or was it really immediate, just boom?
Immediate, but it's like... So the fish comes up out of the water. It's immediate, but the fish was swimming for a while.
Okay.
Where was the fish? Whatever. See, but all the reason it was easy for me to deal with very easy, actually. So I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. Original guy backing band. I got it. And I didn't have to go through a drop-down menu. Didn't have to do it. It was just I looked at it and went, okay. And plus, I don't know whether it was intuitive, instinctual, intellectual, or some other word with an I.
Right.
I don't know. Sorry. I'm in lyric mode. but I have left so many things on the table for so many years. Mm-hmm. The publishing of more books, the classes that I want to teach, the interaction, my own self-development comes largely from me having to teach and talk about it to people.
Right.
You know, at some point, I mean, I see the whole picture, the grid, and I know what I can't do, and that inspires me. But anyway, the answer to your question is I got a call and understood the call and said, okay, let's do a joint statement. And okay. And then the next day I'm like, okay, I'm having coffee and quite literally, you know, at my think tank doing, oh, how am I going to, you know, looking at my list going, how am I going to complete this job now? How am I going to fix this or do that? I have a lot to do. You know, right. my studio facility had construction. There's stuff that had to be fixed. I had to wait. I'm like, let me just let all of this stuff happen and breathe and just finish these things. So that's what my mindset was. I can't tell you anything different because that's what it was. Sure.
All right, I'm a devil's advocate here for a second. And it's only because I'm a guy that knows I have a big ego and I would be mad. And my mad point would be, if I was you, and again, this is me, my mad point would be, hey, I'm the guy that brought the Grammy. You know, I'm the guy that you won the Grammy with. I should get more love than, well, the other guy that quit wants to come back. How did you not have that kind of ego yourself?
Well, A, because I don't know that that's what is the full picture. I don't know that that is what happened indeed. And I don't let myself even think about it. But okay. Because people decide things and I respect that. It's just, it is what it is.
All right. One quick question that has nothing to do with any of this. I'm just curious, as a master drummer, what you think of this guy. I'm sure you're probably aware of him. If not, I'll be stunned. But what do you think of this drummer, El Estepario Siberiano? Have you seen him?
Yeah, he's fun.
He's fun.
Yeah, of course the drumming's great, but I look into what makes anybody great at what they do. There's more to it. It's not just hitting.
Right.
You know. So yeah, I think it's fun, and fun is good. Fun. Allows you to get through obstacles, you know. Fun allows you to relate to people. Fun is a good thing. So that's what I think. Now, my view on him remains consistent with my view on everybody, which is why I don't have a favorite drummer or anyone's the best of whatever any of that talk.
Mm-hmm.
What I do is I just look at each drummer for what they are, for who and what they are. What do they do? And then I kind of see immediately, again, my mind has this ability, I kind of get right to the core of what makes them who they are, like what they do makes them who they are. So I pick something that I think that makes them great, and I pick it from each person. If there are 200 drummers, I'm picking something from each other. Oh, that's a great thing. I don't focus on the old school critical thing, because when I was a teacher at Berkeley, it was as a counselor. That's why I was happy I was a counselor, because I couldn't wrap my head around, but I understood why certain musicians were so critical of others. Like, that guy's a Neanderthal. He's got no groove, man. You can't play. Or this drummer would look at that one and go, that person's they can't rock. They're just a goon. They would start to be insulting.
Right.
Insulted. They didn't even see the beauty in what each other was doing. And I had to step back and go, would you please look at what they're doing that's great and not focus on the things you don't like? Because not everybody is anyone else. And not everybody has looked at the whole grid, which I published, and filled it in. It's like a puzzle.
Right.
I filled it in, but I didn't fill it in deeply with every category. I just made sure I could play everything to a point that I just understood it. you know, it was like my reading. Eventually I read as many views as you could have on something, not so I could take my view and inject it into somebody, but so that my view might evolve. And guess what? So I could communicate to the to different people. So just to understand them, you got to understand right. somebody. You know, and if you don't take the time to know what they know, how do you understand them? So I took that time, and you asked me about him. And it's like I just latched onto that word because I find that it was that he was able to probably get through the obstacles of that we all face
sure.
because something pulled him through that, and you can see it, and it's yep. fun.
It is. No, I agree with you. He's yeah. he's fun to watch.
Yeah. So I don't I'm not the internet surfer guy.
Okay.
I have too much to do. My family, my kids have even had to tell me who people are. I don't know. I don't listen. I don't watch. I don't get on the YouTube and do that. It's just once okay. in a while, because I have social media, I have no choice. Things fly by or someone sure. says something, and I do, and I see, and I take a minute sometimes, and I go, oh, excellent. And then I go back and do what I got to do.
Right. Makes sense. I figured what we would do, Mike, is wrap this one up with the video for Freak of Nature to give people a taste of it. So, Mike, one more time, tell people where to go to keep up with you and sign up for the masterclasses and buy merch and all that good stuff.
My link tree. Well, it links to my store. I have all kinds of stuff that's used from actual studio sessions and tours and things. It's fun. Okay. It's very affordable. The classes, you get a lot. You save yourself a decade, I think. So it's
right.
very, very good deal. My books explain things in layman's terms. They step you through my Vimeo video service. Literally steps through every thought, so there's no stone left unturned, so the person studying it will not fail. It will not fail if they use it.
Very good. Well, one more time, Invisible Signs, Mike Mangini is out there now. The master classes are happening now. Make sure if it comes to your locale that you go and check it out. And Mike, this has been really great, man. Thanks for joining me here on CHRIS AKIN Presents.
You're welcome, Chris. Thank you for having me.
Ever-evolving world of music, artists need to reach their audience faster than ever before. Introducing Too Immersive For You, the Emmy-nominated pioneers in viewership experience. We've revolutionized the way music artists share their material with the world. Our groundbreaking AI engine generates stunning visuals that bring your music to life. Imagine having your own personalized music video, perfectly synchronized to your unique sound in a matter of hours, not weeks. With Too Immersive For You, it's now a reality. Get ready to unlock a new dimension of music visualization. Too Immersive For You, where music meets immersive visuals. Contact us now to discover how Too Immersive For You can elevate your music to new heights. www.musicvideoai.net.